All right, so let's get started. By now, I think you already know me since I'm here rounding at University Hospital a lot. So today we'll be talking about chronic kidney disease. It's a very broad topic, so I'll kind of do an overview of kind of everything under this umbrella, whatever is most important, especially for your, you know, the ABIM board exams and also for your clinical practice, of course. So first and foremost, the definition. I think there is one always the confusing part that whether if the somebody's GFR is normal, whether we still call them chronic kidney disease or not. And the answer is actually yes, that because presence of any even structural abnormality despite, you know, normal GFR still would be called as chronic kidney disease, and if that abnormality has persisted for more than 3 months. And that's just the standard for any, you know, chronicity in our medical world. So the criteria for chronic kidney disease, the first thing, marker for kidney damage, which could be albuminuria, and that could be either moderate or severe. And the definition has basically changed. What used to be called as microalbuminuria, which is now what we call as moderate, meaning urine microalbumin to creatinine ratio of 30 to 300 milligrams per grams. Whereas, and then severe is more than 300 milligram per gram, which used to be called as macroalbuminuria. And then abnormal urine sediment, for example, hematuria, red blood cell casts, of course. Any electrolyte abnormalities because of a tubular dysfunction would also be considered under the chronic kidney disease if it has prolonged for more than 3 months. Then any histologic abnormalities, of course, on a kidney biopsy. Then structural kidney abnormalities. So if somebody has, for example, a solitary kidney, but their GFR is normal, even then they would be qualified as chronic kidney disease. And history of previous kidney transplant. And then, of course, the most obvious one we already know is the reduced eGFR. Then staging of chronic kidney disease is also something which has evolved. At one point, it was just the NKF staging, the National Kidney Foundation, in which we were just considering the eGFR as the, you know, the factor for risk stratification. But now KDIGO has come up with the different staging system, which includes both eGFR as well as the level of albuminuria. So that's why whenever we see any patients in the clinic with chronic kidney disease, we by default always check their urine protein or urine microalbumin creatinine ratio. Now, it has been shown that GFR and albuminuria both independently are associated with mortality and cardiovascular disease and ESRD. That's why this KDIGO staging system is, I think, much better than the NKF system to really identify which patients are at higher risk of progressing to ESRD or higher risk for adverse outcomes. So this is the staging which, you know, when you Google, you'll find this chart everywhere. So initially, when it was just the NKF system, we used to just do the grade G1 to G5, which was based on the eGFR. But then now the most updated one in this, we also say like stage 3, stage CKD stage 3, and then we further qualify it under the A1, A2, and A3 category, which is based on how much urine albumin to creatinine ratio they have. So if you see the color coding, the green is, which is the lowest risk of progression to ESRD or lowest risk for any adverse outcome, actually. Then yellow is moderately increased risk. then the orange or a little bit darker yellow is high risk, and then red is very high risk for progression to ESRD. So in that, if you see that even the patients who have GFR above 60, meaning the first two rows, G1 and G2, if they have albuminuria of more than 300 milligram per gram, they still come under actually high risk of progression to ESRD. So it's not necessary that the GFR should be low to begin with for you to say that this patient is high risk for progression. Whereas on this side, if you see like the A1, which is actually less than 30 milligram per gram, which is normal, in that it basically depends on, you know, as you probably, it's well understood that if their GFR is lower, then they are higher risk for progression to ESRD. I'm assuming that all of you by now know the staging, but I'll still kind of quickly go over the GFR range. G1, which is normal, is more than equal to 90 mils per milliliter. Then G2 is mildly decreased, which is 60 to 90. Then G3A is 45 to 60. Then G3B is 30 to 45. And then stage 4 is 15 to 30. And then stage 5 is less than 15. Then moving on to pathophysiology and epidemiology. So certainly at this point, the incidence and prevalence both for CKD is rising pretty steadily. So about 7% of U.S. adults, which is more, they consider as more than 20 years of age, this is based on KDGO, have a GFR of less than 60. And the prevalence of CKD increases to 12.3% if they also include the albuminuria as the criteria, which is like the new staging system. The comorbid conditions, as you all know, which are increased risk for CKD are diabetes, number one, hypertension, then any cardiovascular disease, infections like hepatitis C, HIV, and obesity independently itself is a high risk factor for CKD. The demographic factor, which you all know, which is the most strongly associated with CKD, is age. So with aging itself, we lose some GFR. After the age of about 30 years, we all lose GFR by 1 milliliter per minute every year. So really, if you can imagine that by the age of 60 years or 70 years, we would have already lost about, you know, GFR of 40 mils per minute. So that's why aging is a very important risk factor in patients with CKD. So 35% of Americans who are more than 60 years of age have CKD. And it is unclear whether CKD is more prevalent in black population, but CKD is definitely more likely to progress to ESRD in black population in all the studies so far. Then most common cause for ESRD in United States, number one, diabetic nephropathy, which is almost half of the ESRD population. And then hypertension, about one third of them. And then glomerulonephritis is about 5%. Part of this, I would say, is also because we don't end up really, you know, doing kidney biopsy for all the patients, right, with ESRD, because they just end up, you know, progressing so fast, or they just come already in a CKD stage 5 or ESRD level that we don't really get to do a kidney biopsy to give them a diagnosis. So most of them end up getting a presumed diagnosis of diabetic nephropathy or hypertensive nephropathy, because diabetes and hypertension itself incidence is so high. Now, it has been, the incidence of ESRD has been increasing steadily. Recently, it has plateaued, but because of now the kidney transplant getting, you know, more popular, the mortality of patients with ESRD has been declining, actually. But that makes the prevalence of ESRD to go higher, because those patients are currently, you know, waiting for kidney transplant. screening. Now, this is one of a bit of an interesting topic, especially from your level, especially if you are seeing the patient in your internal medicine clinic as the primary care physician. As you all know, the CKD patients are going to be usually asymptomatic, so you wouldn't even know what their GFR is unless you actually, do their blood work. So they are often asymptomatic until GFR is less than 30 or unless they have a nephrotic range proteinuria. Therefore, most of the cases are not detected unless patients are really screened for CKD. So therefore, there is a controversy as to which population we need to screen for CKD. Really, ACP guidelines recommend against screening for CKD in an asymptomatic patient if they do not have any risk factors of CKD. Really, because screening them has not changed any of their important clinical outcomes. And ACP also recommends against checking for proteinuria in patients with or without diabetes if, let's say, they are already on an ACE inhibitor or ARB for their hypertension management, because they say that it's not going to change your management. You are putting them on an ACE inhibitor, you are going to adjust the dose based on their blood pressure control, so they don't even recommend checking the proteinuria. Now, this does not mean that I 100% agree with these guidelines. Similarly, even USPSTF says that there's insufficient evidence for screening for CKD in asymptomatic patients. However, ASN, the American Society of Nephrology, does recommend screening all adults for CKD, including those with, family history of kidney disease, of course, diabetes, hypertension, or any cardiovascular disease. The screening in whom it's indicated, you should do by, checking their serum creatinine, which gives you your EGFR, and then also urine albumin to creatinine ratio is important. Then moving on to clinical manifestations of CKD. So yes, it is asymptomatic to begin with, but as CKD progresses and GFR starts falling down, they develop very vague symptoms, like fatigue, some worsening signs of volume overload, worsening of their blood pressure, so hypertension getting uncontrolled, pruritus, which is more of like a uremic symptom. And then when GFR starts going more like below 10, then they start developing more of uremic symptoms like fatigue, anorexia, nausea, vomiting, confusion, and then which can obviously progress to delirium, obtundation, uremic seizures. It's hard to really pinpoint if all the symptoms are, because of uremia or not. So therefore, it's important to just look at the, picture as a whole. And then uremia, of course, can also lead to serositis. Most importantly is pericarditis, which uremic pericarditis, as you know, is like an emergent indication for dialysis also. Then as far as diagnosis goes, again, checking for their EGFR and checking for albuminuria. But why the diagnosis is important is mainly, sure, treatment, but, as you all know, treatment really for CKD is blood pressure control and other things, which is kind of similar for almost all the CKD patients, but it helps in getting the prognosis also and whether they are going to progress to ESRD or in how much time they're going to progress to ESRD. And then more importantly, it also impacts their outcomes and their candidacy to be considered as kidney transplant. And then after they get the transplant also, it helps in, management. So it's important definitely to know the diagnosis, and that's where, all the workup plays into role. Then complications of CKD. There are a lot of complications of CKD. Number one is the cardiovascular disease. And statistics-wise, that is the most common cause of death in patients with CKD or patients with ESRD. So even dialysis patients, most common cause of death is cardiovascular disease. It's one of the strongest risk factors for cardiovascular morbidity and mortality, and the risk increases, as I said, independent of like independently, if the GFR is declining, risk increases, or even if GFR is stable but their albuminuria is worsening, that itself is the risk factor for cardiovascular morbidity. So therefore, all the cardiac risk factors, you know, similarly, be it hyperlipidemia, blood pressure control, should be addressed in patients with CKD as well. The only unfortunate aspect is that all the landmark studies that have been done so far, they have excluded the patients with, advanced CKD, meaning GFR below 30, and ESRD in particular. And therefore, we cannot generalize all of, the guidelines to all the CKD patients. But of course, clinical practice, you look at the patient as a whole, and that's how you manage. Then the second complication, now hypertension, it's a cause as well as it's a complication of CKD. And that's the most important component of managing any CKD patient is blood pressure control. That's what I tell all the patients in the clinic also. There are three things you need to watch: blood pressure, blood pressure, blood pressure. And that's, the key to slow down the progression of CKD. Now, guidelines-wise, so 2017, almost I think all the guidelines have set the blood pressure goal of less than 130 over 80 for patients with CKD. However, we again differ in this in clinical practice because many patients also have bad renal vascular disease. Therefore, I tend to not be very strict in terms of, we don't want the blood pressure also to be like in 110s or 120. As long as it's below 140 over 90, that should also be good. Because if you drop their blood pressure too low, which might be considered normal based on, your guidelines, the renal perfusion certainly gets impacted because of their bad renal vascular disease, therefore causing a sudden decline in their GFR, what we call as AKI, secondary to relative hypotension. So again, the determination of the blood pressure goal in these CKD patients has been hampered because they end up excluding the advanced CKD patients from the clinical trials. SPRINT was the, you might be already aware that SPRINT is one where they did take the stage 3 to 4 CKD patients also into consideration. About 28% of the SPRINT study population was stage 3 and 4 CKD, which is very good. And they did an aggressive blood pressure control for this group, the stage 3 and 4 CKD. And provided the same benefits for reduction in the cardiovascular disease. But the primary outcome and all-cause mortality was similar. So therefore, as I said, we don't want to be that aggressive also in the blood pressure control. The also 2017 ACC and AHA guideline says that ACE inhibitor is the most reasonable therapy in the first line. But if ACE inhibitor is not tolerated, then you use the ARB. Then the next complication is dyslipidemia. CKD is usually associated with elevated serum triglyceride levels and lower HDL levels. Those are the two main things. LDL, really, it can vary upon a lot of other clinical factors, mostly like nutritional status. Dyslipidemia is associated with increased risk of CKD, but really treating the CKD patients with, any of the lipid-lowering medications, it has not proven whether it does prevent CKD progression or not. Studies have shown that treating with statins in patients with GFR of less than 60 or albuminuria does reduce adverse cardiovascular outcomes. I guess the mic is also... Yeah, so really treating with statins does reduce the cardiovascular adverse outcomes. The guidelines right now, KDIGO guidelines or even actually AHA guidelines, recommends to treat with statins for patients more than age 50 with GFR of less than 60 or with proteinuria itself. Independent of their cholesterol levels, stage 1 to 5 CKD, all of them should be treated with statin. That's the CKD population, but the ESRD population, those who are on dialysis, in them, the studies have not shown that much of difference in cardiovascular outcomes, that whether, you know, giving them statins helps or not. So what we usually do is, if somebody is already on statin, when they are started on dialysis, we just continue that. But if they have not been on a statin, they are on dialysis now, it's not like we initiate them unless, you know, recommended from cardiology. So from nephrology standpoint, we do not initiate a statin in patients who are on dialysis and have never been on statin before. Then coronary artery disease, again, another complication, which is markedly increased prevalence in patients with CKD. And this is also explained because there is high prevalence of the risk factors like diabetes and hypertension, but CKD itself is independently associated with coronary artery disease. So even if a patient does not have diabetes or hypertension, but has CKD alone, even then they have a higher risk of CAD. And that's again associated with either lower level of GFR or just proteinuria or albuminuria itself is a high risk. But as you probably already know, that despite this high risk, CKD patients are paradoxically less likely to be treated for prevention, less likely to receive coronary revascularization because of all this, you know, high risk of contrast-induced nephropathy in these patients. The other factor is because the lab studies that are used to, you know, to look at the cardiac markers like troponin T and creatine kinase, they are falsely elevated in patients with CKD, which also makes things trickier in terms of, you know, management in these patients. Whereas troponin I is less likely to be abnormally increased in CKD patients. So if troponin I is high, that is more specific if you have a CKD patient. Again, cardiac enzymes, as I said, need to be, you know, interpreted carefully. Sometimes it's chronically elevated because of chronic myocardial injury from uremia itself. Uremia is also going to make your cardiac markers high. But if it's an acute elevation, that's certainly, you know, you need to look into more of ischemia. Then mineral and bone disorder. This is another spectrum of CKD which has been studied, but poorly understood, I would say. But still, you know, we have been managing their calcium and phosphorus because it's very, very interrelated with CKD. Let's see in this. Yeah. So calcium and phosphorus homeostasis. It's a bit confusing, but, you know, we'll try to go through this. So both calcium and phosphorus homeostasis is basically controlled or regulated by three hormones: parathyroid hormone, then vitamin D, and FGF23, fibroblast growth factor 23, which is something came up in the last decade, I would say, is what we are looking into. FGF23, it's a peptide which is secreted by the osteocytes and osteoclasts. And it's one of the earliest indicators of CKD MBD, actually. We don't check it in lab routinely, but FGF23 is one thing which is elevated the first, you know, in any patient with CKD. So when the GFR starts declining to more between 30 to 60 level, which is stage 3 A and B, that's when FGF23 levels rise. And FGF23 increases renal phosphorus excretion. That's why if you see a patient, even though their, you know, GFR is less than 60, but not less than 30, their phosphorus is usually normal, well-controlled. That's because the FGF23 hormone rises when, you know, their GFR is low, and that increases phosphorus excretion. So our body, our cells, is regulating initially the phosphorus levels. Then also what happens is increase FGF23 levels and decrease nephron mass from CKD. It reduces the conversion of the inactive vitamin D, the 25-hydroxy vitamin D, to 125-hydroxy dihydroxy vitamin D. So active form of vitamin D is what, you know, is being generated in the nephrons. So that is reduced when your GFR drops. And therefore, there is lower intestinal absorption of calcium and phosphorus. Right, so your nephron mass goes down, or, you know, CKD progresses, which causes decreased production of active vitamin D, which in turn then causes poor absorption in the intestines of calcium and phosphorus. Now, when there is hypocalcemia, that's when you're going to have increased PTH production from the parathyroid glands. And when you suppress the absorption of calcium and phosphorus in the gut, that also helps mitigate phosphorus retention and contributes to hypocalcemia. That's another way why patients with advanced CKD are hypocalcemic, which becomes another stimulus for, again, a rise in PTH, and, you know, patients develop secondary hyperparathyroidism in CKD. Now, increased PTH levels is going to cause reduced calcium excretion in the kidney and increased phosphorus excretion, but activate the osteoclast, tell the bones to give me more calcium. And that's why all the CKD patients start having increased turnover. The osteoclasts are always hyperactive in these patients because we want more and more calcium in the blood. The earlier in CKD, PTH-induced increase in renal phosphorus excretion, that enables normal phosphorus levels, which we already talked about. But once the CKD continues to progress, kidneys no longer able to compensate. One is because the kidney mass is also reducing. Secondly, the FGF23 levels also then eventually, you know, stop rising. They do not go down, they stop rising, and therefore they prevent further excretion of phosphorus in the kidneys. And that's what leads to continuous stimulation of PTH. And this is, you know, the diagrammatic representation of the same thing. So basically, as you can see, that kidney increases the tubular calcium reabsorption, decreases calcium excretion, and increases the serum calcium. But if we do not have enough kidney mass, that's going to lead to hypocalcemia, continue to stimulate parathyroids to release more PTH. And that's going to go and act on your bones to cause increased osteoclastic bone resorption. It does not show the FGF23. Okay. As far as the lab abnormalities go, unless GFR drops below 20 or 30, calcium and phosphorus typically remain normal. Once the GFR stops dropping further is when you'll develop the hyperphosphatemia or hypocalcemia. Also, there is a progressive decline in the active vitamin D levels in these patients, and reduced intestinal calcium absorption. Therefore, you want to give them the calcitriol or analog, which is actually the active vitamin D, because they are no longer able to convert the 25-hydroxy vitamin D completely. You still give them the 25-hydroxy vitamin D too. There's also a higher prevalence of 25-hydroxy vitamin D deficiency in CKD patients. That's why I said we should give both 25-hydroxy vitamin D and calcitriol. So KDIGO guidelines state that if GFR is less than 60, you should screen all those patients for 25-hydroxy vitamin D deficiency and just supplement them just like any non-CKD population also. So usually we aim for levels above 30. If the level is below 30, I tend to give them loading dose or high dose of vitamin D or ergocalciferol or cholecalciferol. The only difference between the two is one is plant-based, comes from plant, and the other is animal-based. You give them cholecalciferol or ergocalciferol, typically 50,000 units once a week for 12 weeks or 3 months. And after 3 months, you want to check their vitamin D level again, 25-hydroxy vitamin D level again. If it is above 30, then you just put them on like maintenance vitamin D, which is like daily. You can do 4,000 units or 5,000 units or, also depends on what they can get, whether over the counter or insurance covers and those things. So that's the vitamin D level, the 25-hydroxy vitamin D level. The PTH levels are going to be elevated in these patients, and they progressively increase with worsening CKD. It's controversial whether you want to really, treat the PTH level to go to normal, because, and I'll discuss that further in the next few slides, is if you suppress the PTH too much, even that's not good. In CKD patients, you want to let them have a little bit higher PTH for the ongoing mineralization. Therefore, they recommend that you measure the intact PTH level and manage the secondary hyperparathyroidism, but only towards normal, not an entirely normal range of PTH. Then the next thing comes to the vascular calcification. This is also increasing prevalence of arterial calcification, especially coronary arteries, where that's where they get also worsening coronary artery disease, and that's highest in patients with ESRD. And arterial calcification is going to reduce the vascular compliance, because of which you probably see in most of the CKD patients that their systolic blood pressure is usually high and their diastolic would probably be normal or, even lower. So widened pulse pressure in these patients. And this is what eventually contributes to left ventricular hypertrophy and, HFpEF in all these CKD patients. So most of these advanced CKD patients, you will see HFpEF also be there. It's strongly associated with, cardiovascular and all-cause mortality. Therefore, KDIGO suggests that we treat all the patients with CKD and arterial calcification as the highest category of cardiovascular risk. Really, treatment should be specifically targeted at reducing their vascular calcification. So then renal osteodystrophy. So renal osteodystrophy is basically another term for this alteration of bone morphology in the patients with CKD. And that is kind of an umbrella which covers the osteitis fibrosa cystica, your adynamic bone disease, osteomalacia, and osteoporosis. So the first one, the OFC, or what we used to read, osteitis fibrosa cystica, it's basically due to abnormally high bone turnover. And this is the most common one that you see. And that's because there is just persistently prolonged exposure of the bones to sustained high levels of PTH. So your osteoblasts and osteoclasts, both number is increased as well as the activity is increased. Therefore, the osteoid surfaces are more expanded and therefore an increased risk of fracture. Patients, they might be asymptomatic and then suddenly they just come in with like subtle, just trivial trauma causing them fracture. Or they sometimes do complain of bone pain also. then on the x-rays you will see subperiosteal resorption of bone most prominently in the phalanges of the hands. Then adynamic bone disease, although not that common, but if present is very difficult to treat eventually, because what's really happening in adynamic bone disease is bones are becoming more brittle, meaning they're becoming more dense, right? So you need to have both a good homeostasis of osteoblasts and osteoclasts for a healthy bone. But in this, there is lack of bone cell activity. So the other one is too much activity. This one is markedly reduced rate of bone turnover, which basically makes the bone very dense and brittle. The histologic abnormality, you will see, as I said, decreased osteoclast activity, increase in osteoid, and increased risk of fracture here as well. And this happens when you suppress the PTH too much. So if somebody with CKD is coming in and their PTH is, let's say, about 100, 120, this level, it's okay. You can just let them be at that level. Because if you suppress it too much by giving them, more and more vitamin D analogs, they're going to develop adynamic bone disease. Therefore, we have to first rule out adynamic bone disease before you give bisphosphonates to these patients, especially, when you get their DEXA scan and decide to give bisphosphonates. First, make sure they don't have adynamic bone disease, meaning check their PTH and it's not too suppressed. Because bisphosphonates are going to cause worsening by inhibiting the osteoclast activity, as you know. Then osteomalacia, which is decreased mineralization of the osteoids at the sites of bone turnover, and again same thing, bone pain, tenderness, increased risk of fracture. Patients with CKD are at increased risk of osteomalacia, but it does not really cause osteomalacia per se. Vitamin D deficiency, which is caused more because of the CKD, is what eventually makes them at high risk. Then osteoporosis. Now, as compared to patients who have normal kidney function, patients who have CKD, they're going to have reduced bone density no matter what, because of several other causes as we discussed. So really, diagnosis of osteoporosis in these patients just based on reduced bone density on DEXA scan, that's not correct. We shouldn't just diagnose them with osteoporosis because of that. And DEXA has poor predictive value for distinguishing, the histologic subtypes of bone disease in patients with CKD. Therefore, KDIGO actually does not recommend routine use of DEXA in patients with CKD. Then moving on to the management part, prior to dialysis initiation for CKD patients, primary goal is to really maintain, the lab parameters in the normal range. So be it, their electrolytes, acid base, their calcium, phosphorus, PTH, vitamin D. The approach really differs upon what stage of CKD they are in. In patients who are not on dialysis yet, GFR is less than 60, we should attempt to normalize PTH but not suppress it completely. And the first step is to give them 25 hydroxy vitamin D and normalize their serum calcium and phosphorus, because that itself is a stimulus for, the PTH secretion. If PTH remains elevated despite giving them the 25 hydroxy vitamin D, the loading dose which I was telling you for 3 months, then you can consider giving them calcitriol or calcitriol analogs to further suppress the PTH. But really, while you are giving that, you have to closely monitor if they do not develop hyperphosphatemia because of the calcitriol, or hypercalcemia, because it's going to stimulate more and more absorption of those two. So as we already talked about that, then so approach of secondary hyperparathyroidism management is much different in patients with ESRD on dialysis. The reason being also that there are different lab parameters that the Medicare follows for dialysis patients' reimbursement. So that's one of the other reasons too. Now, prolonged PTH stimulation makes the parathyroid glands autonomous. Then they do not care whether the calcium is low or high, what's going on. Parathyroid glands are just going to keep on secreting PTH. And that's where we say this is now tertiary hyperparathyroidism. So, and usually in that case, the parathyroid hormone levels would be much higher, meaning there will be in thousands, 2,000, 3,000, that levels also we see. And typically tertiary hyperparathyroidism we would see only when somebody's ESRD vintage has been high, meaning they've been on dialysis for a long time, then we start seeing tertiary hyperparathyroidism. You wouldn't see usually the CKD non-dialysis patients with that. Okay, so because of there is prolonged stimulation, the elevated PTH levels don't even respond to phosphate binders or calcitriol therapy. We give them calcium mimetics, like cinacalcet, or there is a new one called Parsabiv, which is IV, but they usually fail to respond even to calcium mimetics, and we just end up having to refer them to endocrine surgery for parathyroidectomy. Now, in that also you have to be careful though, because they're not going to remove all the four glands. They shouldn't remove all the four glands when they do parathyroidectomy. They typically remove three and maybe leave one gland, and they just remove it and do what we call as autologous transplantation. So they just put the fourth gland, let's say, in their arm, in like the subcutaneous tissue, so that there is at least some PTH which is releasing. Because as I said, if the PTH is going to be completely suppressed, meaning all their parathyroid glands have been removed, then they're going to develop the adynamic bone disease. So that's also not good. So typically they leave the fourth gland or half of a gland in the body for continuous PTH release. Then hyperphosphatemia, severity, it's directly associated with mortality. Nothing like in short term, but more like a long term outcome. So they should be on the low phosphorus diet, should be on phosphorus binders. And hyperphosphatemia also eventually leads to high risk for calciphylaxis, which is more like, deposition or calcification of the smaller blood vessels, like the skin vasculature, which eventually causes skin necrosis. Then anemia, which is the next complication for CKD. There are different reasons for why somebody with CKD would be anemic. And of course, as the CKD progresses, anemia continues to get worse, becomes more and more difficult to treat also, actually. So the number one factor is because of reduced nephron mass, there is reduced production of erythropoietin, which is what, is most useful for the red cell production. And there is also erythropoietin resistance in patients with CKD, and there is reduced RBC lifespan in these patients. So that's the one thing, erythropoietin related. Then the next thing is iron deficiency. Iron deficiency is more common in CKD patients, and that also causes erythropoietin resistance. So even if the patients don't really meet the criteria for iron deficiency anemia, you have to keep their iron stores depleted so that the erythropoietin or EPO would continue to work and they don't develop EPO resistance. Therefore, we first like to, check their iron studies, bring up their iron stores, and then give them EPO. Otherwise, pharmacy will be ding, 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 you cannot give EPO. They keep rejecting because it's expensive and it will not really work if you, you know, the iron stores are not good. So KDIGO recommends that the TSAT or transferrin saturation level to be more than 30% in these patients and ferritin level to be more than 500. You either give them oral or IV supplementation. Oral iron is good to give in the beginning or if the TSAT is less than, you know, 25 to 30%, that level. But if it is severe iron deficiency and CKD is advanced, or, you know, patient has had some sort of chronic inflammatory disorder, you probably have to give them IV iron. The reason being, when they have CKD itself is a chronic inflammatory disease or chronically inflammatory, you know, state the body is in, because of which the hepcidin levels are always high in these patients. And hepcidin is what causes internalization of the ferroportin channels in the gut. And if the ferroportin is going to not be there, the oral iron will not even get absorbed in these patients. So that's why in advanced CKD and severe iron deficiency, you want to give them IV iron instead of just oral iron. Then CKD-related anemia, if it's purely CKD-related, it will be normocytic. But most of them, they're iron deficient also. So, you know, it may be microcytic as well. Then there's really no specific test to establish, you know, the diagnosis for anemia of CKD. Because we don't really, you know, measure erythropoietin levels. They are going to be often decreased in these patients. Once the GFR starts declining below 30 is when the anemia starts becoming, you know, symptomatic in these patients. So that's why all those symptoms like fatigue, anorexia, we don't know if these are more like uremic symptoms or is this more related to their anemia. So first we treat their anemia and only then say that, no, this patient is probably getting more and more uremic, so they probably need to initiate dialysis. So we give them erythropoietin stimulating agents, ESAs or EPO. There are a lot of other, you know, analogs that are coming, darbepoetin, Aranesp, Mircera. These are all basically, you know, different categories based on their duration of action and half-life. So ESAs as such avoid the need for transfusion, but really we need to look into their benefit and risk before we give them ESA. We don't want to make their hemoglobin go higher than 11, 11.5 by giving them ESA. And because that comes with more risks, because there is higher risk of malignancy. It causes more tumor progression. There is high risk of cardiovascular, cerebrovascular events. So if somebody has had a stroke or a recent MI, you really want to be careful to see whether you want to hold off on giving them ESA or not. Of course, if you are at a point where they had a recent MI, their hemoglobin is just not coming above 7, they are going to end up needing a lot of blood transfusion, but they're also somebody who is, you know, potential renal transplant candidate. You want to avoid giving them more and more blood transfusion, then we just give them ESA and kind of discuss the risks of higher cardiovascular events with the family. And as I said, don't increase their hemoglobin above 11, 11.5 in these patients. That has been shown to have a higher risk of, you know, stroke or MI. Then metabolic acidosis, again, another common and important complication of CKD that all of you see, or even AKI. And that occurs because kidneys, one of the important functions is to regenerate bicarbonate. So when the kidneys are not going to be able to regenerate bicarbonate, with the carbonic anhydrase cycle, then you're going to end up having metabolic acidosis. There are large observational studies only which have demonstrated strong association between lower bicarb levels and adverse clinical outcomes, including CKD progression also. So there used to be a thought where we would give patient's sodium bicarbonate, even if their bicarb is 19, 20, so not that low, but give them bicarb to keep their bicarb closer to like 22, 23, closer to normal range, to even prevent CKD progression. And that has been shown to, to have good outcomes. Now, of course, giving them too much sodium bicarb can also have its own risks. One is they can develop metabolic alkalosis, but, you're monitoring their levels, of course. But the other thing is they are getting some sodium load also in this when you're giving them sodium bicarb. And given that most of these patients have history of hypertension, heart failure, they're going to get more and more volume overloaded if you continue to give them so much sodium. So if you feel like their metabolic acidosis is now well treated, take them off the sodium bicarb so that you are not giving them so much of sodium load. Then nephrotoxins, so that was the complications part of it, which I know is pretty broad. Nephrotoxins, of course, there is higher risk of AKI if somebody already has CKD. So you want to be more and more careful to avoid these nephrotoxins in patients who have CKD. And with each AKI episode, CKD progresses irreversibly. So if somebody's GFR was 30 today and then they develop an AKI, then after the AKI resolves, they will probably not come back to that GFR of 30 or, creatinine of 2, let's say. They will then probably have a newer baseline of creatinine of 2.2, 2.3 and, a lower GFR. So it's very important to prevent as much as possible AKI episodes in these patients so that they don't progress in their CKD so fast. So hence all these patients, we tell them not to take over-the-counter NSAIDs, also tell them to avoid any like herbal supplements, nutritional supplements, because they've not been really studied, no clinical trials, but they can cause, AKI or be nephrotoxic. So this is like the list of over-the-counter medications that you should avoid or use with great caution in CKD patients. As I said, analgesics-wise NSAIDs, including the COX-2 inhibitors, so those celecoxib and all, even those you should avoid. Adverse effects being AKI can cause hyperkalemia, high blood pressure, right, because prostaglandins are being inhibited. Any of these decongestants like Sudafed, phenylephrine, they will cause increased blood pressure in these patients. Laxatives. This is another thing which, we commonly recommend, especially things like enemas which contain high sodium phosphate. You don't want to give them those laxatives because that can cause hyperphosphatemia. Magnesium hydroxide you should not give because of hypermagnesemia risk. Similarly, in antacids, giving them magnesium hydroxide, aluminium hydroxide, sucralfate, all of those can cause aluminium toxicity as well. Then nutritional supplements, creatine. So many of, the bodybuilders or they take these supplements or protein shakes which has creatine in it. They don't really look at the ingredients, but that's one thing to ask them. It can cause fluid overload. Secondly, a factitious increase in creatinine. So you don't know whether the creatinine is high because it's just that their creatine load intake is high, or is it because their CKD is progressing? And then sometimes it can cause AKI too. I'm not sure much about this germanium part. Then salt substitutes. That's the other thing. We recommend them a low-salt diet, so they end up taking some salt substitutes. But really, what are those made of is potassium chloride, because that's also going to give them some salty taste and seasoning in their food, so that ends up causing them hyperkalemia. So it's important to always tell the CKD patients, low-potassium diet, but also, low-sodium diet, but also don't use the salt substitutes. Then herbal remedies. One is this aristolochic acid. This is for some reason a very popular question in the ABIM board exams. They will ask you, somebody has this chronic tubular interstitial, AKI, and they were taking some Chinese herbs, which usually tend to contain aristolochic acid. I've never seen this in clinical practice, but they will ask you in boards. The reason being it causes chronic interstitial nephritis is why they have renal dysfunction. Proteinuria. So as I said, the severity of proteinuria itself is strongly associated with adverse clinical outcomes, including progression of CKD, cardiovascular morbidity and mortality. There are several large randomized control studies that have been done in which ACE inhibitors or ARBs, they decrease proteinuria, they slow the progression of proteinuric kidney disease. We are always afraid of giving them ACE inhibitors because we are afraid, oh, the creatinine is going to go high if you give them ACE. But that's okay, because actually your job is to actually reduce their glomerular filtration rate, their GFR, a little bit to reduce the proteinuria so that their CKD does not progress. So when I'm explaining to the patients, I always, like to tell them that it's kind of like driving a car at 120 miles per hour will break down faster than driving a car at 60 miles per hour. Sure, slow down the GFR a little bit, but it will last longer. CKD will not progress as fast if you reduce, the proteinuria in these patients by giving ACE inhibitors and ARBs. Okay. So, that's about that. Protein restriction, another controversial topic. We don't want to actually restrict somebody's protein intake because, they have CKD, because it has not really shown any benefit in terms of CKD progression or anything. But it has been shown that if they are at advanced CKD stage 5 and you're trying to prevent them from going on to dialysis, then you should recommend to take low protein diet, because it may not, then they may not get uremic signs and symptoms as fast. So it will, prevent them from pushing on to needing dialysis. So we usually recommend 0.6 grams per kilogram per day. Then since we are running out of time, special considerations, contrast, I think we all already know. And then NSF risk from gadolinium. So if somebody's GFR is less than 30, we want to avoid giving them any MRIs with gadolinium. Vaccination, pretty much similar recommendations, just like, any non-CKD patient also. Most only important thing is you want to vaccinate them against hepatitis B virus, because on dialysis they have higher risk of getting Hep B. Vascular access, you want to preserve, their arm vasculature for their future dialysis access. That's their lifeline. So that's why we recommend against doing PICC lines in most of these patients. Then older patients, once, they get above 75 years, it's important to discuss first with them, whether they really want their remaining life to be going to a dialysis center 3 days a week, and, instead of that, have a goals of care discussion with them. All right. Thank you.